May I have your attention, please? Worship will be starting in 1 minute. Please take this opportunity to prepare your hearts for worship and to be seated. And don't forget to put your cell phones on silent.
Praise the Lord. Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I am Apostle A.G. Mullen of Abundant Life International Baptist Cathedral, where we're reaching the unreached and discipling the undiscipled throughout the world for Christ. We welcome you this morning to our morning services, and we want you to feel free to give God all the glory, to give Him all the praise, and to magnify His holy name. For truly, He is worthy to be praised. Enjoy our praise and worship. Enjoy the Word. And I believe that there is a word from the Lord. So once again, enjoy our morning service. We love you and we appreciate you very much. God bless you.
Amen. Come on, let's put those blessed hands together. Come on, hallelujah. Oh, come on, we can do better than that. Come on, let's put those blessed hands together. Let's begin to open our mouth. Let's begin to magnify the name of the Lord. For truly, this is the day that He has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Come on, good morning. Come on, good morning. Begin to just shake yourself. Shake all of the heavy weight, all of the things that have got you bound. Begin to just set them aside and begin to focus on God and begin to press your way in to get the breakthrough, get the deliverance that you need in the name of Jesus. Come on, I'm not going to stop until we all put our hands together, until we all begin to open our mouth, until we all begin to press in His presence in the mighty name of Jesus. Come on, people of God, we're celebrating 27 years of Abundant Life International Baptist Cathedral. Come on, y'all. It's been 27 years. We ought to be glad about it. We ought to exalt the Lord, for He has kept this house, for He has kept our pastor. Y'all ain't saying nothing. For He has kept this ministry for 27 years. So the least we can do is give Him praise. The least we can do is give Him honor. The least we can do is magnify Him for all that He has done over the 27 years of this ministry. Certainly we are excited to be in the house of the Lord. We're excited again that this is the 27th anniversary of this ministry. This is also the 27th year that our pastors have been pastoring. Oh, come on, y'all. Let me say it one more time. This is the 27th year that they have been pastoring this ministry. So come on, let's give God praise for this great house. Let's give God praise for our great leaders. Let's give God praise for what he shall do in this house on this morning. Hallelujah. And we know that our theme this morning is recommitment and restoration. That is the theme for the year 2022. That's recommitment and restoration. I'm going to read our opening scripture. You all have heard it before. I'll be reading from the book of Joel, the second chapter, verses 25 through 29. And the word of the Lord reads, "And I will restore to you the years that the locusts have eaten, the canker worm and the caterpillar, and the pommel worm, my great army which I sent among you. And ye shall eat in plenty and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God that have dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be ashamed." Verse 27 says, "And ye shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God, and none else, and my people shall never be ashamed." Verse 28, it says, "And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions." Verse 29 says, "And also upon the servants and upon my handmaids in those days will I pour out my spirit." Hallelujah. It's recommitment. It's restoration. Hallelujah. As we get ready to go before the throne of grace, let us prepare our hearts and our minds for prayer. Father, we thank you this morning, God. God, we come before you boldly this morning, God. God, we come before you, Lord, with an open heart, God. We come before you, Lord, with an open spirit on this morning, God. Father, you know the need of every person in this house, God. You know the desire of every person in this house, God. You know the need of those who are watching, oh God, via live stream on this morning, Lord God. Come on and have your mighty way on today, God. Father, we come, as we said earlier, God, just to thank you, Lord, for 27 years of this ministry, God. We thank you, Lord, for this building at 1518 Gumbrash Road in Jacksonville, North Carolina, God. We thank you, Lord, for our pastors, oh God, Apostle Aubrey Mullen, oh God, and Pastor Vanessa Mullen, God. We give you praise for them, oh God. We ask that you continue to bless them, oh God. Continue to keep them, oh God. Continue to keep them in your bosom, God. Continue to wrap your loving arms around them, oh God. God, we thank you for the people of this ministry, God. Everyone that has come through these doors over the last 27 years, God. I ask, oh God, that you begin to bless them even the more, God. Right now, in the name of Jesus. Your scriptures say, in the last days, you will begin to pour out your spirit upon all flesh, God. Father, we are seeking you today, God. We need you today more than ever, God. In the name of Jesus, oh God. Father, we thank you for the things that this ministry has done, God. From the city of Jacksonville, God, all the way to Africa, oh God. In the name of Jesus, oh God. God, we're praying for revival, oh God. Come on and revive us again, God. We're praying, oh God, that we begin to move, oh God, to continue, oh God, to reach the unreached. Come on, somebody. And to disciple the undiscipled. In the name of Jesus, oh God. Father, you said write the vision and make it plain, God. For the vision has been written, God. And make it plain so he that read it can run, God. God, we are reading it on today, God. Father, we are ready to run, God. We step out on faith, God. In the name of Jesus, oh God. Now come on in this place, God. Like only you can, God. Come on and bless your people today, oh God. Send the mighty word, God. Bless our speaker this morning, oh God. Bless him, oh God, from the top of his head, Father, all the way down to the soles of his feet, God. And God, while you do it, God, we'll bless your name. Come on, y'all. God, while you do it, God, we will ever give you praise. Come on, we pray these things in Jesus' name. Come on, people of God, it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come on, y'all. Amen and amen.
The day that the Lord has made.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
I will rejoice and be glad in it.
I will rejoice and be glad in it.
Come on, say this is the day that the Lord has made.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
I will rejoice and be glad in it.
Hallelujah. We bless your name.
Hallelujah.
We pray.
sing. Hallelujah. Oh, I still see our pastors dancing. Y'all don't let her dance by herself. Come on here. Don't let her dance by herself. Lift your hands and begin to worship the Lord. Oh, God, we thank you. We bless your name, oh Jesus. For there is none like you, oh God. Hallelujah. Woo! Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Who will stand against the Lord? No one can. No one will. Who will stand against the King? No one can. No one will. Oh, oh, oh. Victory belongs to Jesus. Victory belongs to Him. Oh, oh, victory belongs to Jesus. Yes, God. Victory belongs to Him. Yeah. Who stands?
Who will stand against the Lord?
No one.
No, no one.
victory belongs to Him. Victory belongs to Him. Oh, victory belongs to Him. Yes, it does. Victory belongs to Him. Help me say victory. This morning, victory belongs to me. Yes, it does. Victory belongs to me. Come on, I need every heart lifted this morning. Say, victory belongs. Yes, I am victorious in Jesus. It belongs to me. Come on and
Praise the Lord. If you got the victory this morning, come on, put those blessed hands together and give God some glory and give God some praise. Come on, Abundant Life. Let's give God the glory and give him the praise. Hallelujah. Look around at your neighbor and say, neighbor, the victory is ours. Ooh, hallelujah. We do greet you with divine love. Hallelujah. And we thank God, amen, for our music ministry. Let's give God some praise for our praise and worship, our music ministry. Amen. Helping to usher us into the presence of the Lord on 27 years. Come on. Can I get a great big hallelujah? A great big thank you, Jesus. Amen. For blessing us, amen, to celebrate 27 years. God has been good. Amen. We thank God for you today who have pressed your way to be in attendance. Amen. And we thank God for each and every one who is watching us online. Amen. We appreciate you so much, especially all of Abundant Life, our family, and then all of our friends far and near. We appreciate all of you so, so very, very much. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Amen. I am just excited. Amen. And we know that because of so many things that have been going on, amen, we have not been celebrating the amen anniversary as we traditionally do. Praise God. We normally start with a whole week of service, amen, and end up, amen, on this particular day. And we have so many activities and so many things going on for every social group, amen, every age, amen, and just so many things that we do, amen, to make it a very festive time in the Lord. Amen. But today, amen, we are here. Somebody say, we are here. And it is by the grace of God, amen, that we are still here. And so we appreciate what the Lord is doing in our midst. And so we want you to just, amen, sit back and relax. Amen. Enjoy. Continue to enjoy the music. Enjoy, amen, the message and just being in the presence of the Lord. Amen. We are excited today, and certainly our prayers do continually go out to all who are dealing with sicknesses and disease. Of course, we want to continue to pray for the bereaved family, the Gainey family, and just so many others, amen, who are just dealing with so many different things. We want to continue to uplift them in the Lord. Amen? Amen? Praise the Lord. Amen. And so we're going to have a few things. I think we're going to have some refreshments that you can just take with you after service today. Amen. And as we are celebrating the year 27, we are asking, amen, each family to do 227. Amen. That sounds like a room number. Amen. 227. Amen. Praise God. Each family and each individual that can, 127. But I tell you what, if you can't do that, do what you can. Do 27, whatever you can. But we want you to help us. Let that be your first fruit, amen, for this year. Amen. Whatever you can do. And you don't have to get it all done today. Amen. But we're asking, amen, out of the goodness of our hearts, amen, that you would help us to continue to meet the expenses, amen, of this ministry. And so we're asking, amen, families 227, individual 127, amen. And we understand it's a lot of things going on. The economic situation is not like we would all like it to be. Inflation has hit us higher than it's been in many decades. Amen. I used to travel a lot to Zimbabwe, one of the poorest countries, amen, on the face of the earth. But their inflation was so high that they couldn't even afford hardly bread off the shelves. Amen. We are beginning to understand that a little bit now. I think even in America, that in a land of prosperity and all that we have, amen, things are just sky high. And so we are sensitive to that, amen. And so we're not asking you for thousands of dollars, amen. We're asking you to do 227 and 127 and 27 as the Holy Spirit leads you on today. Amen. Somebody say hallelujah. Praise God. And remember, you don't have to get it all in today, amen. But I think we got 5 Sundays this month. And so, amen, you still got a couple more Sundays, amen, to get it all done. We would appreciate it very, very highly. We are tremendously blessed today to have in our presence, amen, a great man of God, amen. And I say great, great man of God because he's my friend. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. And we're going to be blessed by the word from him on today. Amen. I do have a bio in here somewhere. Amen. If I can find it. Glory. Hallelujah. My wife had texted to me and I'm going to find it now. Amen. Praise God. I may not be as tech savvy as some of y'all, but I'm going to find. Amen. I think she sent it to me on my. It's a text message. There we go. It's in the file. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Now, I got to put my glasses on, y'all, because some small print here. Praise God. But first of all, amen, as I stated, he is a friend. Amen. During Hurricane Florence, amen, we were suffering down here. Y'all remember how it was. It was a rough time for us. Amen. But God used this man not only to bless this church, but to bless the entire area. Amen. He got in contact, amen, with truckers, got in contact with Walmart, amen, and over 100 cases, amen, pallets, not cases, but over 100 pallets of water, amen, that he brought into our area, among many other things. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Not only that, but there were some churches that needed, amen, some restoration done to their facilities. He brought in teams of workers, volunteers, who completely renovated and restored churches in New Bern and in other areas in our area. Praise the Lord. He is the brother, amen, of Sister Denine, amen. Where is she? Stand up, Sister Denine, amen. Praise God, amen. Amen. And we just thank God for her. He is an accomplished preacher. Amen. Right here from Jacksonville. Homegrown. Somebody say homegrown. Amen. Dr. Williams has served as pastor of Diggs Memorial United Holy Church since 2009. Dr. Williams' pastoral work focuses on social health and economic advancement issues affecting the church and the community at large. In 2016, Dr. Williams completed his doctorate degree in ministry at United Theological Seminary in Dayton, Ohio. Amen. You're doing something when you go there. Dr. Williams is an accomplished soloist and musician and a long-standing teacher and mentor. Amen. He currently serves as the executive director for the Triad Mentoring Coalition, a nonprofit minority male organization. Amen. Dr. Williams has demonstrated strong commitment to community outreach. Amen. That's what we're all about. Amen. And so he has served internationally, traveling, amen, to Brazil, Aruba, Medellin, Colombia, Belize, and most recently to Cuba, Haiti, and the Dominican Republic to assist in Hurricane Matthew, amen, disaster relief. In addition to his pastor responsibilities, Dr. Williams is employed by Wake Forest School of Medicine as a community liaison and outreach specialist to work closely with the Maya Angelou Center for Health Equity and Alzheimer's Disease Research. Amen. I'm so proud, amen, to be able to present to you all on our 27th anniversary. Amen. Certainly well, certainly long overdue. Amen. But we thank God that he's still with us and still here. And I want y'all to stand, amen, and show some appreciation and love, amen, for someone who God uses in a tremendous way. Amen. He's going to come in his own way. Amen. He may want to sing. He may want to, whatever he wants to do, we're going to allow him to do it. Come on, let's say, man of God, we appreciate you. Bless us today. Amen. Dr. Lamont Williams. Come on. Amen.
Thank you. I certainly want to give praise and honor to God, who is still head of the great Christian church. I celebrate the fact that as long as he's still on the throne, everything is going to be all right. Amen. I want to just take a moment of privilege and just celebrate my friend over 27 years. I remember when your pastor came to this city and took this city over by storm. I was here during that time, and I celebrate the progress. Because you know God will progress you if you stay with him. Somebody should have been a moment of celebration right there. I believe I said again that God will progress you if you just stay with him. God bless you. I want to also celebrate this wonderful energy in the personality of Lady Mullins. Amen. What a testimony you have here. Amen. We keep up with each other all the time, and I'm just excited about what the Lord is doing continually in her life as well. And so my time is here for preaching, and I want to be respectful of yours. You know, you have to get in a posture for preaching. Yeah. The preachers understand that. And so just allow me to say, shine on me. Oh, shine on me. Let the light from the lighthouse, let it shine, shine on me. Kind Father, shine on me. Shine on me. The light from the lighthouse shine, shine on me. I'm sorry, y'all. I just had to get that out. Amen. And if you have your Bibles, maybe you heard that I was coming and you wanted to bring your Bible to check up on me, to make sure I am in the Word, I'm going to invite you today to the book of Psalms. You'll look at Psalms number 73. Psalms number 73. I want to read 10 verses in your hearing. Psalm 73, starting at verse number 1. And if you'll allow me today, I'd like to read from the Contemporary English Version. You can follow along as best you can. It starts by saying God is truly good to Israel, especially to everyone with a pure heart. But I almost stumble and fail because it made me jealous to see proud and evil people and to watch them prosper. They never have to suffer. They stay healthy. And they don't have troubles like everyone else.
Verse number 6, their pride is like a necklace, and they commit sin more often than they dress themselves. Their eyes poke out with fat, and their minds are flooded with foolish thoughts. Verse 8, they snare and say cruel things, and because of their pride, they make violent threats. Verse 9, they dare to speak against God and to order others around. Verse number 10 finally says, God will bring his people back, and they will drink the water he so freely gives. I want to put a quarter in the meter, and I want to hang out, amen, at verse number 2. But I almost stumbled and fell. Right there, that's what I want to hang out. And would you look at your neighbor quickly, amen, because my time is running out already. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, the preacher is going to preach about where you stand determines what you see. Now, maybe they got upset because you was talking with them. Look at another neighbor for me quickly on your way to your seat and tell them, neighbor, the preacher is going to preach about where you stand determines what you see. You may be seated today in the presence of the God on the 27th anniversary. Where you stand determines what you see. One day, 6 blind men decided to go to the zoo. They hired a guide to tell them about all the exotic animals they couldn't see. When they came to the elephant, the zookeeper wanted them to have a more than a verbal description. So he allowed each of them to feel the elephant. Since the elephant was large, and since the zookeeper had limited time, he let each man catch a touch of one part of this giant elephant. The first man, he reached out and his hand grabbed the elephant's tail. Ah, he exclaimed, the elephant is like a big rope. The next man felt a massive elephant leg. He looked strange. No rope was that big. No, the elephant is like a log or a tree. He was sure of this. The third blind man walked forward and ran straight into the elephant's side, whereupon he pronounced, the elephant is a really big wall. Another man, he was blind. He went and reached out and took hold of one of the elephant's ears. It must have tickled because the elephant wiggled the large ear, causing the fourth man to exclaim, oh, see this. The elephant is like a big fan. The fifth man decided that the first four were all slightly drafted and that they couldn't be describing the same creature. So he carefully walked up and put his hand. He said he put his hands out, and the elephant raised his trunk to the man who felt it and grinned in wonder. My friend, it is obvious the elephant is like a huge snake. The final man was totally confused. All of them blind. He walked forward and reached out his hand, hoping to really find the truth, and encountered a tusk. He paused and brightened and said, I understand. The true nature of the elephant is this. He is a sword. The zookeeper and the guide smiled at one another, knowing that none of them had seen the big elephant picture. Catch that. This was the problem which confronted the writer of Psalms. He was looking at the situation from the wrong vantage point. case and if you missed it, it was nothing but a picture that they were looking at. How often are we guilty of the very same thing? I believe this character in the Bible is named Aspa. And I came to tell you that Aspa has some cousins in Jacksonville, North Carolina. These cousins often look at life from the wrong perspective. There are times when terrible things come over our way during the course of our lives. And when these things happen, we tend to overlook at what we can really see. However, there is far more to the picture than what meets the mortal eye. And I came by on this 27th celebration to remind us all that it's really about what we see. And it depends on where you stand as to what you really see. The psalmist teaches us that we to get our eyes off the circumstances. Won't you say amen right there? Yes, and to place them squarely on the Lord himself. Our friend Asper was ready to quit. I tell you, he got some cousins in Winston-Salem. That's where I come from. And I found out here in Jacksonville, where I'm originated, he got some cousins here too. Folks that are ready to quit because their eyes are on the wrong thing. Yes, and he was ready to throw in the towel and just walk away from God. However, he learned to look at things not from a human perspective, but from a godly perspective. Who am I speaking to on today? God wants you to readjust your vision and see things from a godly perspective. You see, like those six blind men, where a person stands determines what the person sees. And that is a thought I want to leave just briefly with you. If you're trying to time me, I promise you I'm already halfway through preaching my sermon. Bless your soul. Amen. I came to remind you that it's all about where you stand. It will determine what you see. Now, I got three little things I want to talk about. Maybe you want to take notes and be able to just check me out later just to make sure that I was where I was supposed to be. Lest somebody say, Apostle, he read that text and ain't said nothing about it yet. So I want to talk about verse number one, first of all. And I want to talk about Aspa's education. Point number one is Aspa's education. In the first verse, we see Aspa standing on solid ground. He has been taught about the goodness of God. He has been taught that the Lord is nothing but good. Can I get a witness in this place? Is there anybody that I'm speaking to that, number one, can say, I am educated because down through the years, I have found that God is good. And his goodness is not predicated on my goodness. Can I talk to somebody in this place? Who can raise your hand and say that God was good to me when I wasn't even good to him? Aspa was educated because he found out that God is good. And I love that because sometimes I'm not even good to myself, let alone good to somebody else. But I've lived long enough to know that God will bless you in spite of. Old folks said, he looked beyond my faults. Who am I speaking to today that can say, I am a witness that God looked beyond my shortcomings and he blessed me instead? Aspa was educated because he realized that God is good. God blesses his people. This is a true statement. Well, how many know, for the Lord is good, and he's a God that shines light on the just. Got some Bible readers in here. And the unjust. Because sometimes we don't even deserve the goodness that God has given us. Some of us are driving cars that we don't even deserve. I know I'm talking good. Some of us are living in homes that we didn't even qualify for. Some of us are on jobs that our resume doesn't even distinguish that we should be on. But God is good. And he gives us many times, 27 years later, some things that we don't deserve. But he's good. God blesses his people. And then God blesses the poor. Don't run past that one now. For in Psalm, David says he has surely goodness and mercy. Can I park right there for a moment? Because sometimes, you know, we need mercy when we don't do what we're supposed to do. Who am I speaking to that can say, oh, Reverend, you on my road now. Sometimes things get on my mind. I ain't got no business having them up there. But when I look around, God blesses me instead of. We need mercy. 27 years, God has shown mercy to Abundant Life. Come on, say amen, somebody. Yes, 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 yes. But don't run past that. David said, goodness also. Because some people don't believe that God rewards good and faithful living. Is there anybody that can say, I love the Lord and he heard my cry? No, it's so. And the reality is, don't let nobody fool you. My grandmama says, serving God will pay off after a while. Is there anybody that's determined to run this race until the end? Man said, I got to see what the end is going to be. So number one, Asper was educated. He found through his experiences that if you stay with God, God will stay with you. But every now and then we slip along the way. And Asper says, I found out that God will still be right there with you. Yes, because I found out, listen, one of the things I love about serving this God of mine, I heard this songwriter said that justice demanded. Apostle, they teach you not to shout in your own sermon, but I'm doing the best I can to keep myself. When I consider the number of times that I should have been cut off, who am I speaking to in this place? Oh, I know folk don't want you to talk about it. When I consider the times that I would have been cut off if it hadn't been for God on my side. When I consider the times of folks that said he ought to have been cut off. But God stepped in and told justice, I'm going to let mercy have its way. That mercy paid the price, put money on my account that I didn't even have. Paid my debt. And now I can say I'm free. I'm free. Thank God Almighty. I'm free. Listen, justice, if it had had its way, many of us would be sleeping in our graves. But oh, thank God for mercy in this place. 27 years later. So number one, Asper was educated. And then number two, Asper was experienced. Yes, there it is. You find, as Asper had learned the truth about God, but what he experienced in life seemed to contradict what he learned. Who am I talking to in this place that can say to me, Williams, I've learned, I've studied my Bible, I know what the Bible says, I've learned basic scriptures that talk about being recommitted, about being restorated, but somehow or another, what I read and what I'm experiencing, they don't line up. Thank you, Jesus. Tell somebody today, amen, that there's a space where your experience doesn't equal what you've been educated on. who am I talking to today? The reality is there is this word, what we learned a long time ago, it's called a cognitive dissonant moment. Let me talk about that for a moment. A cognitive dissonant moment. It's a theological term where everything you have been taught comes head on with what you're experiencing right then. And it causes a tension that many times you can't put in words. Well, who you talking about? Come here, Paul. Paul was on the Damascus Road. He had been taught to go and persecute folk that were not in line with the Roman church. And then he meets this man called Jesus on the Damascus Road. And he has an experience. The Bible said, knocked him off the beast. God help me here today. And the Bible says, and it was in that moment that Paul had a cognitive dissonant moment. So who am I speaking to today that will say to me, Williams, what I have been experiencing during this pandemic is not equaling to what I have been reading and is experiencing and have been taught as a child. Because I was taught that if you go to church and if you pay your tithe, and if you read your Bible, that you ought to have a pretty smooth sailing on your Christian journey. But now here comes a pandemic. Good, honest, church-going folks are laid off jobs. Who am I speaking to in this place today? Good, honest people that are now dealing with a COVID positive test. Who am I speaking to in this place? You can say I have been taught that by his stripes, I am healed, and then you got to lay a loved one to rest in a grave. Who am I speaking to in this place? That it is called a cognitive dissonant moment. That everything you have been taught and what you're experiencing, they don't line up. It is in that moment that Asper says, I got a situation. And look at what he was experiencing. First of all, his first experience was he saw these people that didn't even serve the Lord. Because somebody passed somebody on the street, on a street corner coming to church this morning. And you have to ask yourself, how is it that they ain't even going to church and look like they faring better than us who are coming to church? Y'all ain't gonna talk to me. It bothered Asper that the wicked prospered while the children of God were without. And I said, I look on the TV, I look on the newspaper, and here we have a pandemic. In Winston-Salem, there are churches that have closed, Apostle, because so many people have been impacted by the corona. And I talked with the pastor, and he said, we don't have the finances to keep the church open. And as a result, they had to close the church and then join in with someone else. And then he says, and then on top of that, I had folk with good jobs. Pandemic caused their employers to lay them off. And he said, Williams, what I don't understand about the pandemic is seemingly some of these people who don't even go to church, it looks like they're faring better than us who are in the church. Let that sit. 27 years, folks are going around that look like don't even have God on their mind. And here at the ministry, it seems like there have been us who would be willing to be honest with me. But Apostle, I know you don't have to tell me because we've walked some of the same paths. When you're doing ministry, there are going to be some valley experiences. yet, Asper says, these people are sinners, and they're prospering, number one. Number two, they have peace. It's right here in the text, in verse 4. He watched the wicked live their sin and slippery lives, and many of them slip off into eternity with no problems. If you had a moment to just think for a moment, just think about the people in your area, in your community, in your jobs, that you know they don't serve the Lord. It looked like they ain't never got no problem. What am I talking to? I had a couple run across my memory bank just as soon as I said it. Even one of them, brother, told me he didn't believe in the Lord. Driving a fine car. Looked like he wore around. He got peace. I'm serving the Lord. I got to fight for him. I'm about through preaching, y'all. This Asper said, I see people that got peace and they ain't even talking about the Lord. And then he said, how is it that we that are serving God, time you turn around, there's turmoil. Every time you turn around, there's something always in the way. There's a statement that I say sometimes, when you take one step forward, it seems like life will push you two steps backwards. And I came by to tell you that Asper was dealing with the very same thing, that he had a problem with these folks that didn't serve God and they still had a peace of mind. Then he said, not only did they have a peace of mind, he talked about the pride of the sinner. Because they live the lives they do. Some of them are prideful. Head ain't never down to the ground. I wish I had somebody that would help me preach myself. And then sometimes, watch this, when we come to church, we got to encourage each other. Hold your head up. It's going to be all right. Listen, get a little more pep in your step. And I know y'all don't talk about that, but I'm trying to tell you, I've had to talk to people and apostles. Sometimes they had to tell me the same thing. Williams, hold your head up. Because if you live in this life, listen, there's some trials. If you ain't never been there, if you ain't real sharp, it'll put your head down. It's called a cognitive dissonant moment, where everything you've been talking about, you've been praying for an individual, saying, Lord, heal them, heal them, heal them. And the more you pray, seem like the sicker they get. And then if you're not real careful, then God call them home. And if you ain't careful and start up being prideful, you'll be angry with God. Ooh, stop right there, Williams. I want to talk with somebody today that says it doesn't seem fair. We serving God, and the ones who don't serve God, seemingly, they having a good time. They pride. And then lastly, under their experience, Asper says he found out the progress of the sinner. When Asper took a look at this, it caused him to become bitter in his heart. It's right there in the text in verse 12. He looked at the life he had been living for the Lord in verse 13. He looked at his own share of sorrows. That's verse 14. He looked at a life lived for the Lord, and it broke his heart. I came by to tell somebody today that if you're not careful, the enemy will play tricks on you, but it really depends on where you stand, on what you see. You ought to just tell your neighbor one more time, where you stand determines what you see. And so I like reading verse number 2 in the Christian version, because it puts it in everyday terms. Asper says, I almost quit. One scholar says, my foot almost slipped when I began to consider the way that I was living and the way the sinner was living. I know y'all ain't had those problems, but I've had them. And I came to ask you the relevant question, what problems do you face now? What situation you have on the altar that you're saying it's a deal breaker? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I heard a man say that if God don't heal my mama, I'm going to throw in the towel. She's a good Christian woman. She's been a Christian all my life. And listen, he said, if anybody ought to be healed, it ought to be my mama. And guess what? God chose to heal him, but on the other side. And guess what? I told a brother, I said, brother, what you got to understand is it really depends on where you're standing, brother, on what you really see. Because if you stand on the human side, your mind will play tricks on you. And that's what Asper was dealing with in the text, is that his mind was telling him one thing. And then his spiritual man was telling him it'll be all right after a while. You ought to talk with your neighbor one more time and tell him, neighbor, where you stand depends on what you see. Yeah. I'm about finished now. My last point, we talked about Asper's education. We talked about his experience. And then lastly, I want to talk about his encounter. Yeah, here it is right here. Beginning in verse 17, the mood of the Psalms changes. Asper moves from the slippery ground of a human perspective and steps squarely onto a shouting ground of heavenly perspective. Can I say that again? You ought to hang out around verse 17. We find that Asper's mood changes. Amen. He moves from a slippery ground on verse 1 and 2 unto a spiritual ground on verse number 17. And we find out, amen, when you look at verse number 17, then I went to the temple. I'm closing now. It was when Asper determined that the tide changed when he went to church. Sanctuary is a spiritual term. And we find out, amen, when he got to church, a change came about. 27 years later, I want to tell you, amen, if you want recommitment, you got to keep coming to church. The danger of not coming to church is you will be like Asper in verses 1 through 16. That your vision gets a little unstable. That folk can get in your ear. Child, you going down there again? Every time you turn around, they hand a service down there. But Asper says when he got to verse 17, the tide turned, and the Bible says when he went to church, there's a couple things he found out. Can I talk about them? First of all, he found out the real future of the sinner. Don't you fool yourself, amen, that it can look like you're getting by, but I want to tell you, you ain't getting away. Ooh, thank you, Jesus. That's why serving God does pay off after a while. But you got to keep coming to church, hearing words from the apostle to get your vision up where it's supposed to be. Because sometimes you can be around folk that ain't trying to go to church. And if you ain't careful, they'll stop you from going to church. The future of the sinner is already predicted. For the Bible says the ways of the wicked are already cut off, just waiting to perish. Y'all ain't going to help me preach my sermon. I came to talk to somebody today that, amen, where you stand determines what you see. And I want to tell you, second of all, they talked about the future of the sinner when they got to church. Then they talked about also the foolishness of self. Asper confesses the fact that he had been looking at everything through the wrong lens. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. It was a faulty lens. I remember one time I read in this book about this young man. he was sick and in the hospital, and he had this lady that would keep coming and keep coming and keep coming. And every time she would come to the visitation room, lady, she would say, you doing okay? He would say, yeah. And she would say, why is it so dark in here? Said, they ought to put some light in this hospital room. And she kept coming and she kept coming. And so finally, she said to him one more time, I like coming to visit you, but seem like they ought to put some light in this hospital room. He said, well, I'll tell you what, dude, go to the window. She got close to the window, and he said, write your name on the wall, on the window. She started writing her name, and it was then she realized that the window was dirty. Somebody gonna catch it before tonight, so don't worry about that. The truth of the matter is, it really depends on where you stand on what you really see. And I've come by to talk to somebody today. It really might not be as bad as the devil is trying to make you think it is. You might just have to wipe. Somebody need to do the motion and start wiping your window for recommitment, wiping your window for rededication, because the truth of the matter is, it really ain't as bad as the devil wants you to think it is. I came to tell you that this too shall pass, that no trouble lasts forever. And I came out to tell you that even a hurricane, bad as it is, it's got to pass back out into the ocean. Somebody say amen right there. Give me about two more country minutes, and I promise you, I'll be finished with you. I know my time is way over, but I wanted to tell you. Have we been guilty of saying God don't care? Have we been guilty of saying God doesn't hear me? Have we been guilty to say that God even is not even here? Because our window needed to be clean. I came by today in my clothes to tell somebody that it is about your education. It is about your experience. And it is also about your encounter. Well, this encounter. Can I close the way I want to close today? All right, then that's good. My friend told me it's okay to close like I want to close. Amen. So I'm going to close by telling somebody about this story I heard the other day. And this man was an old man, and he walked around with a cane. And he decided that he was going to go to the store, and he decided he was going to walk. Story goes on that the man took his cane because he wanted some peanuts and a Coca-Cola. Have I got a witness here? And he began to walk down the hallway, grabbed his overcoat, and now he's walking down the sidewalk. And he decided to cut through an alley, y'all, because he wanted to get to his peanuts and his Coca-Cola. Yeah. And so the story goes on that while he was in the alley, a young man came and said, "Old man, do you have a lighter that I can light my cigarette?" Have I got a witness here? The old man had a lighter in his pocket because it was nighttime, not because he was a smoker. Y'all ain't gonna help me close my sermon. And so the young man says, "Can you give me a lighter and light my cigarette?" The old man took the lighter out, but his vision was not all that way clear. So he was holding the light all around, trying to light the young man's cigarette. And he finally got the cigarette lit, and the young man took off running. The old man went on down to the store, y'all, got his peanuts and his Coca-Cola. And I want to tell somebody that he made his way back home. And when he looked at the news that night, there was a big news flash that there had been a murder on the same street that he had just got through walking. They said they wanted to show the person that had committed the crime of killing a young 20-year-old. The man, who is an old man, adjusted his glasses, y'all, because it's really about where you stand as to what you really see. He began to adjust his glasses. And when he said, "Oh my, that's the same young man that I gave a light to." They had him down at the city jail. Are y'all praying with me as I close my sermon? Well, the old man said, "I got to go see this young man, because I just saw him, and I can't understand. I got one question." I said, "I got only one question that I want to ask the young man." He made his way down to the jail. They picked up the phone, and here comes the young man that had committed the murder. He said, "Young man, aren't you the one that I gave the light to and lit your cigarette?" He said, "Yeah, old man, that's me." He said, "But I got one question for you." He said, can you tell me just one question I want to ask you today? In my leave this church, amen, on the 27th anniversary, I got one question for the church." The young man, he said, "Give it to me, old man. What's on your mind?" He said, "I want to know one thing, young man." He said, "Why did you let me live? I saw you before you killed that young man. Yeah. Well," the young man said, "Old man, do you really want to know?" He said, "Give it to me, young man." The young man said, "Well, when you lit that match," he said, "when you lit that match, I saw a big man standing behind you." He said, "What?" He said, "I saw a big man standing behind you. His eyes were like fire. His hair was like lambskin. His knees were like diamond brass. And his shoes were golden slippers. The man looked like the Son of God. And I made my mind up. I can't fight that man. And I came to tell somebody on the 27th anniversary, it all depends on where you stand. God was standing behind a man. And I came to tell somebody, don't you worry about it. Make up your mind that God is right behind me. And I heard James, Job, and all the rest say these words: if God be for us, who can be against us? Am I talking to anybody today? If you're on your way to recommitment, if you're on your way to restoration, you ought to make your mind up that God is behind me. And as long as he's behind me, everything, everything is gonna be all right. You might not like it, you might not want it, but if you put your hands in God's hands, everything will be all right. Is there anybody here made your mind up that I'm going? If mama don't go, I'm going. If daddy don't go, oh, I'm going. Oh, I'm going. If my sister don't go, I'm going. If my wife don't go, going, shout restoration, shout restoration. I dare you to wave your hand. I dare you to wave your hand and make a public declaration that restoration is my season. It's my season. Yeah, yeah. I got good news for you. That your best days are ahead of you. Can I help somebody? If you make your mind up, restoration is ahead of you. I see your future. I see your future, and it looks brighter than your past. Shout yeah! Shout yeah! I dare you to make a bold step. Take one step forward and make a public declaration that I'm recommitting. I'm restorating. Take one step and declare that this is my season. I'm walking in favor. I'm walking in blessings. Who am I talking to today? God says it's your season. I don't care what the devil's trying to tell you. I don't care what you've been experiencing. I don't care what they're trying to put in your path. You ought to make your mind up. Restoration is my portion. Restoration is my portion. Better health. Who am I talking to? Better health. Who am I talking to? The devil is a liar. The devil is a liar. Whose report will you believe? Restoration, it is your season. I see marriages coming back together. I see relationships being restored. I see some folks getting some things that they said you would never have. It's called restoration. But can I tell you something? As I close today, if you go to Job chapter 42, the Bible says that Job got double for his trouble. Who am I talking to? Don't you worry about it. If you stay with God, double for your trouble. God said he gonna wipe them tears from your eyes. Double for your trouble. God gonna give you favor. Somebody shout favor. Somebody shout favor. Wave your hand and say favor is over me. Come on, make a declaration and shout favor is over me. Shout yeah. Shout yeah. Restoration. 27 years, God said to tell you he saw your faithfulness. 27 years, God said he told me to tell you he's seen your experiences. He says now it's time for restoration. What's to come is better than what's been. I came to declare it publicly today that what's to come is better than what's been. God said, told me to tell you that eyes have not seen. Who am I speaking to today? You ought to make your mind up. I don't care what you're looking at. I don't care what you're going through. He said to tell you that your eyes have not seen, neither have ears heard the good things that God got some good things in store for you. Restoration. Restoration. God wants you to know that you've been in the storm long enough. It's time for restoration. The struggle is over. The struggle is over for you. The struggle is over. The struggle is over for you. You ought to declare today. The struggle is over. said, this is my season. God's seen what you've been going through. Come on. He says life and death is in the power of your own tongue today. 27 years, it's time to prophesy to yourself. The struggle, come on. You ought to say it with some conviction. The struggle is. Yes, come on, one more time. The struggle. Yes. Now make it personal. The struggle is over for me. Say. You ought to hold yourself. It's your season now. Come on, you understand it's your season. For me, who will make that declaration? Come on, one more time. Make it personal. The struggle is. The struggle is. The devil don't like it because you're putting positivity in the air. Come on. I want you to say it with some strong conviction. The struggle is.
Those blessed hands together as our elders come forward. Amen. Thank God for the man of God and the word of God encouraging us today that no matter what it looks like, it all depends on where you're standing from. And if you're standing from God's perspective, future is looking much brighter than our past. Thank you, Lord, for reminding us that even though we may have been cognitive dissident in many situations and they just didn't line up what I learned with what I was experiencing, I know that once I got to the house of the Lord, once I got into the presence of the Lord, then I would get that right revelation. Today we have the right revelation. No matter who you are, online or in the sanctuary, Amen. We understand totally. We're not insensitive to what you are experiencing, because even the people of God, those who said, for God I live and for God I die, we go through too. And we wonder why in the world seems like people who are doing evil, amen, seems to get away with so much stuff. But we know that in the end, we win. And in the end, the wages of sin is still death. But the gift of God is eternal life. I don't know, amen, whom God is dealing with or speaking to in the sanctuary, but if you just want to come for prayer, you can come for prayer. If you want to come to rededicate your life to the Lord, you can do that. If you want to come and become a member, amen, you can do that as well. Even online, even as I'm speaking, amen. Maybe someone wants to rededicate their life to the Lord. You want to recommit. This is the year to recommit. I know it's been hard, and it don't seem like what it should be like, but we've got to recommit. We can't let the world and the circumstances of all that's happening cause us to give up on God. Yeah, all of us have been like Asher. We wanted to just throw in the towel and quit. Amen. But we hung in there. We've been hanging in there. Going into the third year, we've been hanging in there. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. God has been good to us, even in the midst of seeing loved ones leave us, even in the midst of having to have to deal with COVID. We're still blessed. We're so truly blessed. And so if there's anyone that desire prayer online, amen, you can touch, amen, your phone, your tablet, that screen, wherever you are, we're going to be praying with you as well. Amen. If you want to stand in the gap for someone that you know that needs prayer, we will do that as well. Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We want to pause right now, God, to first of all to say thank you. Thank you for your manservant, and thank you for your word. Thank you, Lord, for reminding us through your manservant and through your word that no matter how dark the days have been, there is still light at the end of the tunnel. We want to say thank you, Lord, that when we almost gave up, when we almost quit, God, you reminded us that you had our back. You reminded us as that old man, oh God, didn't realize, oh God, why that murderer fled away. But you was right there behind us. You had our back. I'm so glad, Lord, so glad that you got my back. You got my back, Lord. When I was sick, you had my back. When I was down and out, you had my back. When I was depressed and filled full of gloom, you had my back. And Lord, I want to say thank you. Thank you for having our backs. Strengthen us now, Lord. Those of us who are around this altar, you know exactly what we stand in need of. Without a word of knowledge, without, Lord God, a prophetic utterance, God, you already know what your children stand in need of. I pray right now, God, that that same grace and that same mercy that was preached about, that it would be applied to each and every one of us, especially those of us who stand around the altar. Meet us right now. Strengthen us where we're weak. Build us up where we have been torn down. Prop us up on every leaning side in the name of Jesus. Father, we're going to be careful today to give you the glory and to give you all the praise. Thank you, Lord, for 27 years. Thank you, Lord, for establishing abundant life upon the solid rock. Thank you. you, Lord, for allowing us to be participants in kingdom work. Thank you, Lord, because one day when our seasons are ready for transition, I want to hear you say, well done, thy good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. Now I'll make you ruler over many. Thank you, Lord. Save that one that needs salvation now as I pray, God. And as I pray, if you need salvation, even from YouTube and Facebook and Vimeo and whatever social media platform you're on, pray this prayer. If you need salvation, dear God, I come to you as humble as I know how, realizing that I am a sinner. Forgive me for all my transgressions. Wash me, cleanse me, make me totally brand new. By faith, I believe that Jesus died on the cross for my sins, that he was buried in a borrowed tomb, but on the third day, he got up with all power in his hand. I believe that when he ascended back, that on the 52nd day, that the Holy Ghost, he sent it back here. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. That same Holy Ghost that you sent, Lord, let him come and live inside of me. By faith, I receive you now. And by faith, I believe that I am saved. Fill me from the top of my head to the soles of my feet, even with the evidence of speaking in new tongues. I am saved. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. 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 I don't know who you are, amen, but if you pray that prayer, your life has been changed forever. Your name has been written in the Lamb's Book of Life, amen. Somebody come on and rejoice. Come on, let's give God the praise, amen. Hallelujah. Was there anyone that wanted to join the ministry, amen, or rededicate, amen? Praise God, amen. Well, let's give God some praise, amen. Those of you who are online who want to join, amen, just put it in the comment section. Our administrator will get in touch with you and let you know what to do next. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. What a word, what a word, what a word. Hallelujah. Praise God. We're going to move on. Amen. And a time of sharing. Amen. And after a time of sharing, amen, we're going to let you go. We have a few, we probably have a few announcements and then you will be dismissed. Amen. But let's give God one more hand praise. Amen. Great service. We thank God once again for our praise and worship ministry and our musicians. Amen. Traveling in bad weather. We got God bless y'all. Amen. Praise God.
Amen. Glory to God. Come on, let's stay in that same vein. We're still giving God praise. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. Amen. Truly God is moving and his presence is in this place, and I don't want to belabor the hour, amen, but it is offering time, amen. And before I read our scripture, I want to remind you of what our apostle asked us to do right at the beginning of the service, amen, and that is $227 per family, amen, and $127 per person, amen. You don't have to do it all today, but you know what God has placed upon your heart to be able to do. If you don't have it, maybe you have 27, whatever you have, amen, do as God has commanded us to do. Amen. Let me read from Proverbs, the third chapter, verses 9 and 10. And it reads, honor the Lord with your wealth and with the first fruits of all your produce. Verse 10 says, then your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will be bursting with wine. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the offering that we're about to receive, God. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the heart and the mind of every giver in this place, God. And God, we ask that you bless this offering and use it as you see fit. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you would like to be a blessing to our church, here are the 8 ways to give. You can send your gift or offering by mail. to 1518 Gum Branch Road, Jacksonville, North Carolina, 28540. That's 1518 Gum Branch Road, Jacksonville, North Carolina, 28540. Or you can drop off your envelope at the church. We also have our ALIBC app. You can also text ALIBC Give to 833-655-4424. That's text ALIBC Give to 833-655-4424. We have the PushPay app, and we also have our Givelify app at Abundant Life Baptist Church. We have our website, which is www.albc.org, and Cash App at $ALIBC Events. Remember, God loves a cheerful giver. Thank you for your 2021 contributions to the ministry. All donations are tax deductible. If you would like to receive your 2021 contribution statement, please provide your name, address, and member number by either signing up in the foyer or contacting the church office at 910-346-2356 during business hours. Your continued support to Abundant Life International Baptist Cathedral, the community, local, and foreign missions are very much appreciated. We want to wish all those born in the month of January a happy birthday. We pray that it is a blessed and special one.
Amen. Certainly, we thank God for our announcements. Amen. And just a few briefs here, and I will try to be brief. I want to greet everyone again here and in person, and those of you who are joining us via live stream. Amen. I want to read a card. It says, "Love happens in the little moments." Amen. It says, "So glad I get to share them with you." Thank you, Pastor and First Lady Mullen and the Abundant Life International Baptist Cathedral family for being a house where I can find the Word of God and a place where worship and prayers release such a beautiful smell. I know this may come as a shock, but I really love all of you and miss you dearly. Signed, Rashonda Brown and family. Amen. We thank God for that card. Amen. Continue prayers for her and her family. Amen. I want to say happy birthday to Abria, who is our pastor and apostle's granddaughter. Amen. She turned 16 on January the 14th. And this is our year of recommitment and restoration for all of God's people. We're continuing to celebrate our 27th anniversary today. God is faithful this year. This is the year of recommitment and restoration. And prayers, continue to pray for the family of Timothy Ganey, and all those who have lost loved ones during this time. Continue prayers for all of our sick and bereaved families. Amen. We're standing, amen, as we prepare to be dismissed. Amen. What an awesome time we've had today. What an awesome word from the Lord on this morning. Amen. Father, as we prepare to leave this place, but never from your presence, oh God, go with us and be with us until you bring us back into this appointed sanctuary at the appointed time. Father, we pray these things in Jesus' name. It says, "Now may the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace." Amen. Be blessed. And please, we ask that you please exit the sanctuary. I believe that there's something out in the foyer for you, but we would ask that you would please get it and exit the building. Thank you so much. We